Okay. So, good evening to all present here in this online platform of today's webinar. Gajwal Mohabhat Bidya is grateful to all of you who registered themselves and have procured some time to spend for the cause of this webinar. We are well overwhelmed to see such a huge number of registration in this webinar. The number is over 800 students, scholars, teachers, and academicians. Dear all, our college had just stepped into teenage last year. In 2006, the college had been affiliated to the University of North Bengal, and since 2007, courses has affiliated to the University of Gurbango. One of the partners of this webinar, the Department of Political Science, started the general UG course since the inception of the college, and honors UG course in this subject got started just 3 years back. The Department of Education, the giant wing of this webinar, is also as much old as the Department of Political Science in respect of the general UG course. And the honors course started in 2013-14 academic session. At present, we are running both general and honors UG course in 10 subjects. I hope I have been able to give you a bird's eye view of our institution. Now I wish to mention some points to remember for the participants in this webinar. First of all, please keep your audio and video turned off during the program. Next, feedback form will be shared 10 minutes before completion of this webinar. Possibly you have gone through these points in the brochure itself and the message that we sent in the link. E-certificates will be issued after successful submission of feedback form. It may take a week to issue all the certificates given the huge number of participants. Now, I request our principal, sir, Dr. Mahmud Shamsul Haq, and the patron of this webinar, he's also the patron of this webinar, to deliver the welcome address to the resource persons of this webinar, as well as the participants. So, sir, please, over to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Nizarul Islam, Dr. Nizarul Islam. Most welcome to all, to our on the national level webinar on relooking at India's political educational exchange with neighborhood nations. Firstly, welcome to our speakers, Dr. Tanbir Arshed, Assistant Professor, Presidency University, Kolkata, and Dr. Partho Sarathy Mollik, Assistant Professor, Gangadhar Mihir University, Odisha, and two organizing departments, Department of Political Science and Department of Education of Gajwal Mahabidyalay. Their faculty, their faculty Mohammad Akidul Haq, Assistant Professor and HOD Department of Political Science, Dr. Mohammad Mizarul Islam, Assistant Professor and HOD Department of Education, Doymonto Rai, Assistant Professor, Suparto Ghosh, SAC, Amit Kumar Prasad, SAC, Kobita Sarkar, SAC, Dipankar Kundu, SAC, and other colleagues, dignitaries, participants, and my dear students. Gajwal Mahabidyalay is a rural-based college. It is already referred by Dr. Mohammad Nizarul Islam. It is established in the year 2006, and it is affiliated to the University of Gurbango. Next, in the district of Malda, West Bengal. Is located just a stone throw distance from National Highway 34 towards west at Gajol on the northern part of Malda. It has only arts stream with 10 subjects in honors and general courses. During this COVID-19 pandemic period, the college is trying to reach to the students through online class and time to time through this webinar program also. Now we may draw our attention to this important program and the topic concerned. The neighboring countries of India are Afghanistan, Bangladesh, Bhutan, China, Maldives, Myanmar, Nepal, Pakistan, and Sri Lanka. The policy of India towards her neighboring countries is to maintain good relations with them and to settle her disputes with her neighbors peacefully without any intervention of the third party. On the other hand, South Asia is among the most heavily populated regions in the world. However, the region is presenting a distinct window of opportunity for the higher education sector. To meet the growing challenges corroborating with population growth, there is dire need to strengthen higher education sector at par with international standards. Hope we'll be enriched with the encouraging and progressive views of the honorable speakers in this regards. Most welcome and thanks to all again. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your encouraging welcome address. Now, may I request Mr. Akhidul Haq, the head of the Department of Political Science, to introduce the sub-theme of the lecture by the resource person, honorable resource person, Dr. Tanveer Arshed, who will deliver his enlightening speech and share his knowledge in this regard on the subtopic of his lecture of this webinar, Higher Education in South Asian Countries, Reality, Challenges, and Opportunities. So I request now Mr. Akhidul Haq to introduce the sub-theme as well as the resource person of Political Science Department. Over to you, Mr. Akhidul Haq.
Thank you, Dr. Islam. Honorable Principal, Dr. Mohammad Samsul Haq, honorable speakers, Dr. Tanveer Arshed and Dr. Partho Sarathi Mollik, all the participants and my colleagues, my students, a very good evening to all of you. Okay. As you all know, India is known to the world for its peace-loving nature. It's a land where people believe in mutual cooperation and maintain healthy and cordial relationship with all its neighbors. Since its independence, India has maintained good and friendly relations with all its neighbors, Pakistan, Afghanistan, Sri Lanka, Maldives, Bangladesh, Myanmar, Nepal, Bhutan, and China. And still, India has been endeavoring to maintain and peaceful ambience. India's foreign policy is basically based on peace, freedom, and mutual cooperation among the neighborhood nations. Several talks were held and treaties and agreements have been signed to maintain peaceful relations with all its neighbors. If we look at the Panchasil Agreement, which was signed by Indian Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru and Chinese Prime Minister Chou Enlai in the year 1954. The peoples of this agreement were mutual respect for each other's territorial integrity and sovereignty, mutual non-aggression, mutual non-interference in each other's internal affairs, equality and mutual benefit, peaceful coexistence. In spite of these efforts, clashes and conflicts have been taking place in the past between India and its neighbors. And very recently, we have noticed that there were some sort of clashes between India and its neighbors. So it is a highly relevant, timely call to discuss on a topic like relooking at India's political educational exchange with neighborhood nations. Okay, before we enter into our main discussion of the webinar, I would like to introduce our honorable first speaker, Dr. Tanveer Arshad. Dr. Arshad is an assistant professor in the Department of Political Science, Presidency University, Kolkata, West Bengal. His area of interest centers on the changing dimensions of Indian foreign policy, comparative politics, and political thought. He has been with the prestigious SUI Fellowship at the University of Massachusetts from Department of States, United States of America in the year 2018. Presently, he has been working on a paper mapping the impact of the Belt Road Initiative on the South Asian nations. He has been published and presented various papers in reputed national and international journals and seminars. I want to request Dr. Tanveer Arshad to present his re-evaluating India's neighborhood first policy.
Hello. Yeah, can I start?
Shona jacche.
Can I start? Ami shuru korbo? Okay. So first, warm good evening to all the August audience who have been really kind enough to make themselves available for today's webinar. Before I start my presentation at the outset, I would like to extend my deepest thank and regards to my friend and my colleague, Professor Aqidul Haq, the head of the Department of Political Science, Gajol Mahavidyalaya, for giving me this opportunity to present my thoughts on the changing dimensions of Indian foreign policy, specifically how it reacts or acts according to the changing nature on the neighborhood policy. My sincere gratitude also goes to Professor and Principal Gajol Mahavidyalaya, Professor Shamsul Haq sir, and Professor Neez Jamal Islam, the head Department of Education, for providing me with this kind of platform and allowing me to express and pour out my limited thoughts and ideas on India's foreign policy vis-a-vis its neighboring states. Before I move ahead with my presentation, I would like to clear some aspects at the very beginning. Number one, for this presentation, I have used a lot of maps, graphs, and tables. Most of them may be subjected to copyright. Due to paucity of time and space, I was unable to mention the name of the authors and the owners, but I duly acknowledge them and their work in preparing my presentation. Number two, it's not per se specifically a country-specific presentation, as the name of the paper itself suggests. It's a broad attempt to encompass the major policies and changing dynamics of India's approach towards its neighbor. However, in the due course of discussion, I would like to take some effort to deal on some core specific country specific areas vis-a-vis India and its neighbor. But this paper predominantly and mostly primarily focus on nature, the changing contours of India's neighborhood policy. And when I use the term neighbor, it encompasses a very large multiple nations. But to make it in a more and to limit myself on the time, I would specifically focus on the close vicinity of the SAARC seven close sister nations, so that I can give more time in explaining that what are the major changes that we have witnessed since from 1947, what are the changing contours that we are seeing right now, and what can be the possible option which we can look into. Giving this brief idea, I would ask my friend Akidul to kindly. Okay, before I start my presentation, very clear, I am a little bit weak in this technical glitches, so I might take a little bit of time in order to make myself presentable in front of the audience. I hope now the slides are visible. I would ask my the moderators to kindly focus on the slides in the paper instead of like giving it.
Okay, sir. Yes. Slides are prominent.
Thank you so much. Okay. So let's begin. So giving this brief background, so let me begin my today's presentation. It's an attempt. It's an unfinished paper which I'm recently working on, but I would try to justify as much as I've worked on. So the name of the paper itself suggests it's re-evaluating India's neighborhood policy, colon, that quotes. So it basically means that an attempt is being made to evaluate the existing domain and discourse of India's foreign policy towards its neighboring countries. I would like to begin my presentation quoting our former Prime Minister, Dr. Manmohan Singh. He believes that the real test of a foreign policy of any nation lies in the handling of its neighbor. So this gratitude, recognition, importance, and priority in dealing with the neighboring nation or the states are often paraphrased as the neighborhood policy in the discourse of international relations or foreign policy. In this neoliberal interconnected world, specifically after the 90s, this neoliberal interconnected world order, apparently this policy, giving due recognition, due gratitude to the neighboring countries, is by far the most important core policies which holds true to almost every country of the world. The reason and the rationale is quite simple. It basically means development without destruction. Or if I try to make it in a more simple word, it means uninterrupted focus for development for attaining national power or national interest. Although this policy appears to be a very convenient diplomatic maneuver, but when I come into the practical sense, it is far more challenging and far more difficult in the practical approach of safeguarding and upholding the principles of the foreign policy vis-a-vis the maintenance of defense of one's nation's interest and one's national priority. India, undoubtedly, after its independence, due to the strategic location and the landscape, has always been enjoying a very special position in understanding the geopolitics of South Asia. Being the only South Asian country, due to its location, centrally located, it shares its borders with all the other seven South Asian sister countries, be it Afghanistan, be it Pakistan, be it Nepal, be it Bhutan, be it Bangladesh, be it Sri Lanka, be it Maldives. And even if I go in the eastern world, I'll find Myanmar and even China also. So it's quite clear that it's because of the geopolitical and geostrategic location, it enjoys a very lucrative and simultaneously a very humongous task in mediating and maintaining with its neighbors. this paper was an attempt to delve deep or explore deep into the problematic domain of shaping and framing a balanced foreign policy for India, specifically a balanced neighborhood foreign policy for India. Through an evaluation of an existing framework and an attempt to rethink the outline proposed policy, we'll try to keep in mind that the recent political upheaval which's happening, the border skirmish, the political disorder, and the diplomatic exchange, heated discussion, which is happening, it's quite clear enough. And thus, I believe I can make my paper justified enough to make it clear that how relevant it is for the present day discussion on India's foreign policy, specifically India's neighborhood policy. So given this background of my paper, I would like to move into the next slide of my presentation, which talks about the outline of today's presentation. So if you can see the slide, it's quite clear that I have focused on four major onus or outline of today's presentation. I'll begin primarily with the politics of policies and policies of politics, which basically talks about a narrative of India's neighborhood policy since 1947. Moving then, I would like to focus on mapping the changing contours of India's neighborhood policy. Third, I would like to focus on the most important and the hot topic of today's discussion on the Modi doctrine or Modi and the neighborhood. And finally, I have made an attempt to reevaluate the first in India's neighborhood first policy. So this is what primarily my presentation will circle around. These are the four major broad sub theme which I would like or intend to present in today's 40 minutes or 30 minutes presentation, whichever the moderator feels like. Okay, so as I'm aware that there is another speaker who is going to speak after me, and due to the paucity of time, so what I'll try to do is that I'll try to, and I believe that the August audience present out here are well aware about the basics of Indian foreign policies and how the changing contours are the changing dimensions of Indian foreign policy. I will try to skip certain basics, and I've tried to merge the first and the second section of today's presentation, which mainly talks about the politics of policies and mapping the changing contours. So the first section, the first section, which is the politics of policies, in this section, basically, primarily, I would like to focus that how after the dawn of independence, how during the dawn of independence and the wake of Cold War, we gave birth to a neighborhood foreign policy, which I would like to call primarily was an Indo-centric muscular foreign policy. The phase can be clearly mentioned as from 1947 to 1980s. This was a phase of a preeminent Indo-centric muscular foreign policy. Primarily after the withdrawal of the colonial rule from the United Undivided British Indian Territory, the Indian policymakers were primarily interested in shaping a very unique foreign policy, unlike the masters, who were primarily interested in using the neighboring countries as a This was practically why, after the hurried and unplanned withdrawal of the British government, the neighborhood policy occupied a very significant position in the discourse of an independent Indian foreign policy. In one of his speeches, our first Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru quotes that the Asian Nehru quotes that before the British, India always had contact and intercourse with the neighboring countries. But for the last two centuries, it has been almost completely isolated from the rest of Asia. So if I try to deconstruct the speech, it makes clear enough that immediately after the withdrawal of the British, policymakers, or specifically Jawaharlal Nehru, was making it clear that now it's time to reshape or rebrand the entire Indian foreign policy or policy of India towards its neighbor with due and important, significant and imperative shadowing India's stand towards its neighbor, specifically in the bipolar world. This was what led to the birth of the two most important policies, which till date is regarded as the cornerstone of India's foreign policy. One was in the year 1954, the Panchsheel, which my colleague Aqidul Haq has already mentioned, and 1961, the non-aligned movement. Why these are important? These are important because of the framing or trying to frame a independent foreign policy for India. It was a bipolar world. The wave of Cold War was pre-evident. Superpowers were practically trying to strengthen their bloc by multiple military and economic policies. Standing at a moment, coming up with a policy like non-alignment is not only remarkable, but I would like to call it a brilliant move or a brave move for a newly independent country like India. Primarily, it was the then global power politics that accorded this newly born Indian state for providing a greater importance to the international issues and the neighboring countries. Now, it's clear that this phase was marked by a clear-cut Indo-centric policy. The policymaker at that point of time were keen in visualizing a greater role for India in the world politics through policies like NAM, anti-colonialism, freedom movements. And these were primarily what was getting reflected in diplomatic talks or books of diplomacy. Eventually, this Indo-centric foreign policy, which was created in the backdrop of, I would like to call it, third worldism or third world politics, eventually started taking its shape and ethos in the spirit of giving more and more due importance in the regional level. It started giving due and more importance to the Himalayan neighbors. What we started looking into is that from 1949 to 1950-52, India started building up a very cordial relations with its neighboring, specifically Himalayan neighbors, be it Nepal, be it Bhutan, be it recognizing the PRC, People's Republic of China. This third worldism politics of third worldism and giving due prominence to the neighborhood started getting reflected from Nehru's policy. And by this point of time, we started getting a very cordial relationship. So in the year 1949, India, Bhutan signed the famous friendship treaty. So by the next year, it was India and Nepal, and eventually India and China, the famous slogan of Hindi Chini Bhai Bhai. So it was clear that India was trying to make up a strong stand in the regional level as well as in the global aspect. By this point of time, by early 60s, and due to the border dispute and the Tibet dilemma and the war of 1962, eventually the relationship between India and China started getting better enough. And this led to the birth of a new prime minister, a short-lived prime minister, Lal Bahadur Shastri. What is more significant after Shastri's era was the incoming of Prime Minister Indira Gandhi. She basically started to took a step ahead and extended this policy of Nehru, which later on came to be known as the Monroe Doctrine. It believed that the subcontinent in which India is lying is an exclusive sphere of India, and New Delhi must strive hard to prevent the intervention of any great powers in the affair of the region. Like her father or her predecessor, Mrs. Gandhi's policy was more militarily powerful and politically stronger. But this has a lot to do with the then world politics of Cold War, which was happening. Because by that point of time, it was clear that neither the United States or the USSR needed intermediaries. And the politics of aid and economic assistance and India's aspiration to become a nuclear rising power in the region led Indira Gandhi to shape such a muscular foreign policy, specifically towards its neighbor. Now, why it's called a Monroe Doctrine? It's because if you remember, by this point of time, be it 1970s and the Shimla Agreement, 1970 or 1987, the Indo-Sri Lankan Accord, by this, in the, during this phase, India made it clear that we need to resolve dispute, misunderstanding between our neighbors through bilateral negotiation. So this eventually led to the birth of a preeminent Indo-centric muscular foreign policy, and the neighborhood was quite getting evident, like the neighborhood foreign policy in this discourse was quite getting evident due to this changing nature of India's foreign policy. So we started with the scratches after the British left. We started with a cordial relation in order to build up a strong connection with our Himalayan neighbors. In the regional level and in the global level, we tried to project the politics of third worldism. And eventually, with the changing nature of the global politics, we, from an Indo-centric foreign policy, we started moving up to a more muscular policy towards our neighbor. So by 1980s, this attitude or this policy of India in dealing with its neighbor had already created a thaw in India and in the relation between India and its neighbor. As regional politics or the politics of region started spilling its beam over the internal domestic politics, India started adopting more dominant neighborhood policy. Its high-handedness, big brother attitude, and a muscular way in order to deal and collate with its neighbor had clearly frozen the relationship between, be it Bhutan, be it Nepal, be it Sri Lanka. One could easily witness how the changing attitude of these smaller South Asian nation towards India's policy was getting reflected in shaping its global image or maintaining the status quo in the region. By this point of time, the regional disturbance and this so-called Indian muscular foreign policy in Pakistan, it was clear enough that the anti-Indian sentiments and in the region was clearly getting a safe haven to breed in these smaller South Asian nations. Meanwhile, if we can recall India's non-aligned stand in the global politics during the Cold War, it was clear and evident enough that greater power like United States and its allies were also trying to settle their scores with India. We can recall that how in 1971, the Bangladesh Liberation War, Bangladesh, America's direct assistance by sending its 7th fleet in favor of Pakistan, and how the intervention of USSR was clear enough to see that India was now having a tough time in sailing its ship through the diplomatic maneuvers, be it in the region or be it globally. By mid-1975 and early 80s, relations became so critical, especially by that point of time, there was annexation of Sikkim also. So by 1975, the annexation of Sikkim and the critical stand taken by Nepal in vehemently criticizing India's Sikkim annexation policy of Sikkim was practically making India a backdoor player major diplomatic fields in all major diplomatic platforms. It was high time by 1985 that India started thinking of bringing a change in this policy. So let me make myself clear once again that whenever we try to read a foreign policy of a nation, any policy of any nation has by the then world order. So there are a lot of critics who considers this muscular, powerful, high-handed attitude of India and big brother attitude of India and Indira Gandhi's policy as one of the major key reasons for how the relation between its neighbor started getting deteriorated. But one needs to remember that the policy of every nation somehow or other gets directly or indirectly affected by the global politics which happens during that context. This was preeminently the first phase which led to the which led to the birth of the second phase, that is the phase of regional attack cordial and a policy of inclusivity. So it was clear that by late 1980s, it was clear that India, if it needs to uphold its policy of becoming a rising power in the region and globally, needs to change or twerk a little bit its attitude towards its neighbor, its policy towards its neighbor. There was something wrong which was going on, which led to the birth of the second phase, which I have called as the phase of regional apartheid cordial and the policy of inclusivity. So if you can look into the timeline, it basically says by late 1980s and 2014, what was happening at this point of time was, by early 90s, Soviet Union disintegration, end of Cold War, and the new economic world order with this liberalized, private, globalized economy was taking its shape, and it was directly affecting the policies, domestic as well as the foreign policy of India. So by now it was clear that India's big brother attitude towards its neighbor was significantly badly affected its position in the region and the world politics. So India, being a significant region in the world, it had to either adapt with the changing scenario or need to suffer with the wrath of this. So by the end of 19th and the 21st century, the administration of Narasimha Rao, Rajiv Gandhi, I.K. Gujral, Manmohan Singh actually brought a marvelous breakthrough revival in relaunching its neighborhood policy. This was specifically witnessed when, in the domestic politics of India, for the first time we witnessed in the year 1977 the incoming of a non-Congress government at the center, with a new Prime Minister, Prime Minister Morarji Desai. The onus and the mindset was clear that they need to remove, that India need to remove the misunderstanding and banish the fear of interference from New Delhi towards the smaller countries. So by maintaining a low diplomatic profile and a credible friendship and worthiness, it rebranded its policy towards the neighbor. Simultaneously, after Morarji Desai's government, the second non-Congress government, which came after Indira Gandhi, was Prime Minister Vishwanath Pratap Singh in the year 1989, who on the same line adopted a same low profile and a flexible attitude in dealing with its neighbor. So he believed, let me quote him, that our approach to the neighboring countries will be one of friendliness, no arm twisting or any bullying tactic. I want to make this clear. Strength lies in mutual understanding. So a prime minister of a nation making clear this sort of a low profile, a credible dialogue, significantly affected the mindset of these smaller countries or the neighboring countries of South Asia. Be it SAARC, be it the Gujral doctrine, be it the Lukist policy, India was now acting in a much more mature, much more responsible player in the region. This also had a lot to do with the wave of LPG, liberalization, privatization, and globalization. And this wave of economic building of India through this LPG was acting as a boon for flourishing and promoting India's vision in a much more resilient form. From bilateral negotiation, India was now moving into multilateral platform in order to resolve issues, in order to take up developmental cause, in order to accomplish its national interest, and in order to desire and the desire to be a major rising power in the region, India was much more flexible, much more friendly in dealing with its smaller neighboring countries. One of the most one of the most extraordinary development which happened during this point of time, practically, which I would call that after Nehru, which can be regarded as the backbone of India's foreign policy towards its neighbor, was the incoming of Prime Minister I.K. Gujral, Indra Kumar Gujral, and his policy of Gujral doctrine. For the first time, India realized that the phrase "United we stand" will only become if it can extend its helping hand towards its smaller South Asian countries. With this Gujral doctrine, India started enormously spending development economic aids towards smaller South Asian countries. Now, this was actually the greatest turning point and India's relation with its neighbor. So with focus on the Himalayan countries, India gave special priorities in mending up its relation with its smaller countries, specifically like Bhutan, by giving huge investment in the hydroelectric sector's potentials. It renegotiated the 1949 Bhutan's Indo-friendship relation, where one of the most important major bone of contention was, where India said that India could maintain or India could overview Bhutan's foreign policy. With Nepal, India started, India rejuvenated with a fresh zeal. It started shaping up its new policy, its new approach in dealing with Nepal by signing the accord with Cape Bhattarai and VP Singh by 1990s. The end of long 14 months of economic blockade, the visit, the revival of the diplomatic visit by these smaller countries, the Kathmandu New Delhi joint accord, the opening up of transit routes, restoring of trade relations, importing the goods from the smaller countries, reducing the excise rates, like these were clear, and it was quite evident that India was now acting in a much more mature and a much more responsible player in the regional level, as well as this actually helped India to rebrand itself in the global level itself. So eventually it started having a very good relation, cordial relation with the United States of America, which at one point of time was one of the closest ally of a troubled neighbor. And and in the regional level also, not only Nepal and Bhutan, by 1990s, the Indo-Sri Lankan accord, which was signed, and the setting up of joint working groups or joint institutional frameworks, this was heading a way ahead. Even in Bangladesh, the incoming of Khalida Zia, India was doing an incredible job and a headway movement in trying to resolve the Teen Bigha issue, which later on got in the last past few years has been resolved. So India was successful in instilling the sense of trust, sense of faith, sense of reliability, sense of credibility among the mindset of the foreign of the policymakers in these smaller countries. So it was so eventually after the this policy kept on moving ahead with the incoming of NDA and the UPA government. National Democratic Alliance, or be it United Progressive Alliance, both of them almost maintained the same policy and same attitude in order to deal with its neighbor. They started to pursue the policy. They started to pursue the same policy or the same approach in dealing with its neighbor by creating a network of interdependence, civil society, people-to-people contact, opening up of diplomatic borders, platforms, joint working committees. And this was carving a beneficial and benevolent face of India in the region. And with Pakistan also, eventually the bus diplomacy, the Agra summit, it was clear enough that India was ready to forgo the past and look for its present. Okay. And the optical fiber bone, which was the Nepali Terai region, the rail agreement with Nepal, the hydroelectric projects, the Dhaka Agartala bus services, the ferry services between Colombo and Kochi, Mumbai and Karachi, these are some of the extraordinary move which was evident and which was quite relevant in understanding the changing nature of India. I thought of, if I am allowed to use, I was thinking of, by this point of time, a UP government, I was thinking of quoting the then foreign secretaries, some of the speeches of the then foreign secretary, specifically Shyam Saran and Menon, Shiv Shankar Menon's argument on how India was dealing it. So if I'm allowed to, if the moderator allow me, how much time do I have? If the moderator can tell me, how much time do I have?
You have at least 15 minutes.
I've got just 15 minutes.
Yeah, sir.
Okay, so I think I need to. So let me skip these things. So eventually it was clear that be it Kashmir, be it Lahore, be it Jaffna, be it Dhaka, be it Kathmandu, be it Thimphu, India was successfully evident in creating an atatkardial in the region level. This led to the birth of the third phase of my today's presentation, which is the phase of camaraderie or collaboration from 2014 with the incoming of our Prime Minister Narendra Modi, and how it changed it. Now, if you look into the next slide, yeah. So if this slide, it makes it clear. So what I've done is that in my previous deliberation, I was trying to show that one can easily find out that there are two different set of mindset in order to deal with India and its neighbor. On the left hand side, I can see Nehru along till Rajiv Gandhi, and the right hand side we can see VP Singh, VP Narasimha Rao, IK Gujral till Manmohan Singh. I don't find box. After the incoming or with the landslide victory, Modi started neither a policy of a muscular Indo-centric, which I can't clearly ignore, rather, nor was his policy a soft, a flexible, low-profile attitude in dealing. So I, in this graph, if you can look in the picture, I have kept Narendra Modi somewhat, who is out of the box and does not fit into any of the two existing set of policymakers in the discourse of dealing with its neighboring nation. So immediately after assuming the landslide victory, Modi invited, or Modi's foreign policy reflected a strong signal in rejuvenating SAARC by inviting its neighboring countries. He made his first attempt in Bhutan, eventually followed by Nepal, stopping over in Lahore on his way home from Afghanistan, greeting Nawaz Sharif in his birthday. These were a strong signal and a strong signal to prove that Modi was more focused on rejuvenating the regional organization, which by that point of time was almost dying its natural death. India started dedicating a satellite for the SAARC. It started implementing the SAFTA, South Asian Free Trade Zone. India's gesture of duty-free access to the less developed countries. Its plan to start a network-based exchange, unclassified information, and eventually India's proactive leadership role in encompassing and taking ahead with the SAARC nation in this COVID pandemic is remarkable. So it was clear that Modi, after him coming into power, he has given more and more focus into rejuvenating and reviving the South Asian Regional Cooperation Organization. His interpersonal relationship his body language, his soft power diplomacy, his fashion diplomacy, which I'll talk about a bit late, was sending a clear-cut message that the Modi doctrine was a somewhat altogether a complete new, if not a complete new doctrine in order to deal with its neighbor and uphold India's foreign policy in the region. So India started investing. So as per the Economic Times, in the last four fiscal year, India's investment for the neighboring countries amounted to 21,000 crores, and in the 2020 and 21 budget, it's investing around almost 5,000 crores, which is around 68% of India's total foreign aid for its neighboring countries. Another landmark feature of Modi's doctrine or Modi's foreign policy is policy of federalism in the discourse of dealing with its neighbor. So what we were witnessing now, or what we are witnessing now, is that in its external policies, India's neighborhood policies, are deviating from Delhi-centered, which were initially managed by few. If I look into the graph, we can clearly see that India is now giving a free hand to the state leaders or head of the states, federal states, in negotiating the partner, negotiating with the neighboring countries. Say, for example, Bihar, UP has a close tie with Nepal, Bengal with Bangladesh and Bhutan, the Northeast zone with Myanmar. So this interpersonal relationship, this cultural linkages, is used by present day government in order to strengthen its foreign policy towards its neighbor. The fifth and the most important another factor which one can witness in Modi's doctrine on Modi's foreign policy towards his neighbor is a clear-cut importance to the maritime linkages. This has a lot to do again with the present existing world order and China's idea of Belt Road Initiative and Maritime Silk Route. India has started investing more and more in its maritime partners, be it Sri Lanka, be it Maldives, be it Andaman. So India's giving more and more importance to this maritime linkages is yet, and to protect its strategic autonomy vis-a-vis China, is yet another admirable move by the present government. Okay, so on one hand, we can see that India is adopting a very close interpersonal soft power cultural linkages this government is adopting in order to deal with its neighboring countries. On the same hand, we can also see that there is also a bossiness or also strong attitude of India in order to deal with its neighbor, be it the surgical strike, which the intervention in Myanmar and killing of the terrorists. And so these are some of the areas which we can see. I would like to focus on one important aspect of this government policy, what are the basic premises of Modi's neighborhood policy: rejuvenating SAARC, soft power and fashion diplomacy, economic and cultural diplomacy, moving from bilateral to multilateral negotiation, maritime linkages. Now, fashion diplomacy is quite a new term which I would like to focus on. So if you look into these pictures, you can clearly see by this point of time, fashion diplomacy, those who are aware about the discourse of foreign policy or IR, it was a well-discussed, detailed topic in the West. Like, what is Michelle Obama going to wear, or how George Bush is going to deal with its state guest, or but this was never a so-called idea of discourse which was talked in Indian context or India's foreign policy. So if you look into this slide, if you look into these pictures, this so-called fashion trend of Narendra Modi, our prime minister, it's clear enough that how he's giving more and more focus to the soft power diplomacy, cultural exchange, which by far remains the very a sensitive issue in dealing with any country. So till this point of time, the picture, I have tried to map the changing contours of India's foreign policy towards its neighbor from an Indo-centric, muscular, low profile based to a camaraderie which Narendra Modi is coming up from Nehru to Modi. I have tried to map up the changing contours of India's foreign policy. But our mind changes when I look into this slide, the next slide, which talks about the ground realities. When I look into the ground realities, it's pretty evident and the picture is quite gloomy on the other side of the grass. It's clear enough that with Pakistan, the Kashmir dispute is still lingering. Terrorism is by far the most important bilateral issue which still lingers in between India and Pakistan. Afghanistan is a bone of contention between India and Pakistan. With Bangladesh, we are still trying to deal with problem of illegal migration and most specifically the Teesta water sharing. With Nepal recently, Limpia Dura and Kalapani and Susta, these territorial differences are there. With Sri Lanka, the issue of maritime boundaries, fishing, and with Maldives, the present growing of Islamic fundamentalism, which is breeding ground for anti-Indian sentiments, are really a matter of concern. Now, these are the present realities, and in order to look so, why it is so, I have tried to focus on the next slide, which talks about evaluating the fallacies, that is the problems which one can witness or India's policy towards its neighbor. I have mentioned, I have tried to project 7 basic problems which one can easily find out once you read or try to analyze India's neighborhood policy or India's policy. Is the arbitrary South Asian borderlines. I think this is by now it's clear, and in the course of discussion I've made it clear a lot of time that the hurried and the unplanned withdrawal of the British government had led to the birth of an problematic borderlines in the South Asian region. So be it the NEF, be it NEFA, be it Aksai Jin, be it India-Pakistan, we are seeing that these unresolved border lines somehow or other has always been the primary bone of contention between India and its neighbor. Even in Bangladesh also, somehow we have been able to resolve the Teen-Dikha corridor. But then still, the second factor which is by far, I believe, is much more important and relevant than the borderlines, or like the borderlines, if not lesser than the borderlines, are the unstable and inconstant river lines. So if you look into this graph, this slide, primarily there are two direct states with whom we share the problem of water line. One is Nepal and another is Bangladesh. So if you look into this slide, this makes it clear that Limpia Dura, Kalapani, Lipu Lake, or Susta, these borders between India and Nepal has been marked by the river Kalapani or the Kala River. Now, we all know that the river lines are always unstable. They keep on changing their courses. Now, with the changing of the courses, what happens usually is that the tract of land, which at one point of time belongs to India, sometime goes into the territory of the neighboring countries. The similar thing happens with the neighboring countries also. Say, when Kalapani started changing its course of discussion, the Treaty of Sagauli, which was done in the 1850s or 15 or 16, if I'm not wrong, which marked the Kali River, the Kalapani, as the western bank boundary of Nepal and India. India issued, in November 2019, India issued a new political map, which showed that Kalapani as a part of Nepal tract, which is under the Indian. So the Indian Defense Minister Rajnath Singh, in May 2020, this year, inaugurated an 80-kilometer road from Drachula to Lipupa, which is if you can look into the slide, you can see which is in between Limpiadura and Lipu Lake. So it was because of the lack of, it was because of this 80-kilometer construction, the Indo-Nepal relationship has become bitter enough. Okay, and this lack of consensus on the precise location of river lines or border lines has again resulted in creating bone of contention or dispute between India and its neighbor. Okay. The third reason, or the third fallacy, which I believe has been one of the major reason again in order to create a problematic zone in India and its neighbor, has been the short-lived or the reactionary policy of India in attaining its national interest. Now, if I try to deconstruct the word short-lived or reactionary, which means that unlike powerful countries or unlike strong powers in the global field like China, US, USSR, India's policy is always short-lived, is reactionary, and this creates a bigger issue in because its onus keeps on changing. So if you can look into this slide, this is a wonderful slide, as I've already mentioned in before I began. These graphs and these photos are maybe subjected to copyright. I have acknowledged them in my write-up. So if you can look into this slide, the star marks areas are the base of the People's Republic of China, which they are trying to do as a part of their maritime silk route. Areas where China has started making its base in the maritime region, India has also started making similar sort of base in order to counter or make a status quo in the region. So be it Hambantota port of Sri Lanka, India immediately bought the Hambantota airport. Be it the Djibouti in Africa, India started buying Seychelles. Be it in the Bay of Bengal, India started giving more and more focused base in Port Blair, Car Nicobar, so or South China Sea, or so one can or say, for example, when China started making its Gwadar port with as a part of China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, India started focusing on Chabar, although some of them has already been initiated before the initiation of Chinese base camp. But one can easily see that these are pretty reactionary, these are short-lived, an outlook to the policy which greater powers are playing. The third important thing is that India's shifting onus. So at one point of time, India keeps on focusing its due focus to the Himalayan neighbors. Immediately, at times, it changes its focus to the maritime region. Okay. So I would like to, so this graph would like to show that how things are changing. So if you look into this graph, which is basically a projection of India's investment in its neighboring countries from 2015 to 2021. So 2021 is an estimate. So if you look into the taller graph, it's Bhutan. And eventually the yellow one is Nepal. Let me make it clear. India has significantly started investing more and more in Maldives in 2018, unlike 2017. It was high in 2019, but suddenly it became low in 2020. Bhutan, which has always been a trusted partner for India, a buffer zone, very important strategically, has also suffered its economic share in India's development. Nepal, which in 2019 and which was very low in 2017, suddenly reaches a hike in 2019-20 and goes a low in 2021. Okay, Afghanistan, which in 2015 when Modi came into power, started 2014 it came into power and started mending up a very strong relationship with Afghanistan by assuring, by making the parliament and other developmental projects, suddenly in 2020 it has gone down. So one cannot see a very stable, a very uniform, a very long lasting goal which India is persisting or India is playing. So India's attitude in order to deal with its neighbor, it's always changing, in a flux. It's always in a flux. The fifth and the most important fallacy, again, I believe, is that it's far more difficult to engage with India as a bargaining partner. India is far more difficult and it's not easy to maintain. Rather, in comparison to India, bigger power, greater power like China, it's easier to maintain a flexible relation with it. Number six is a bossy camaraderie. Although it's a camaraderie relationship, it's a relationship of a comrades, but it's with walking together. But India fails when it comes to walk the talk. It has always it despite being a cordial friend, has tried to be, if I would add a prefix to it, it has been a bossy cordial friend in it. The way India has been dealing right now with the present government, with its neighbor, has always been a bone of contention. See, I would like to give one example by India, how it was dealing with the Madhesi problem in Nepal.
Dr. Arshad, please conclude.
I would like to take just 5 minutes.
Please conclude. We are already running late.
Just 5 minutes more. Okay. So this is my last slide. As I've got my time, this is my last slide. Okay. The main core thing. We have seen the fallacies. Now, how to reevaluate, or what are the points where we can focus in order to bring in change? First, we need to think for a long-term, far-sighted policies. This graph is a relevant example where we can see that now our focus is act-east policy. So when we are focusing on act-east policy, we should give due prominence to our act-east neighbors. So the Asian Highway and the creating of India-Myanmar roadways and giving due priority to it needs to be given more focus. Chalking out our priorities. Number two, we should need to remember that what are our priorities? Do we need to keep ourselves engaged in smaller petty issues with our smaller neighborhood countries, or we need to aspire ourselves to become a rising power in the world? This needs to be done. As Prime Minister Manmohan Singh says again, that one can't disregard national border, but can eventually and gradually make them irrelevant. How to make them irrelevant? People-to-people contact, cultural linkages, soft power diplomacy, opening up of border, lowering of transit trade. These are some of the options by which we can make these borders as irrelevant, and we can win, as Sun Tzu would call, that we would want to win a war without fighting it. A positive management of a border control, okay, a proactive and an asymmetrical non-win win-win zero-sum game is far more relevant. If you look into the graph which I was trying to show, that India has always been fluctuating, it's changing its debt, it's changing its grants for its neighboring country. Instead of changing its grant year by year, India should maintain a parity. There should be a balance, there should be a uniformity, at least for a long term of time, so that we'll be able to achieve our goal. Finally, the most important one, the strength which India lies in the hand of India is its huge market potential. Two most important things which I have mentioned in this slide is E and C, that's economic and cultural diplomacy, is what make India a top-notch ahead against its contender. I would not call it competitor, contender, China. So if I like to call, if I like to quote Barry Buzan and Amitabh Acharya, Barry Buzan would say that the world will be, there will be no superpower in the world, there will be only greater power. And in the greater power, India lies a very strong, there's a strong potential for India, because unlike China, India has a strong social global acceptability. Its idea of democratization, its idea of free speech, forget about the domestic upheavals which are happening right now in India. That's domestic. When I'm talking about the international domain, when I'm comparing China with India and the atrocities China is doing with the Muslims right now, and so it makes it clear enough. The free press, it's more transparent. So this is what, and another is India must focus on giving due recognition and upholding its neighbor. We have a very strong connection with Bhutan. But if this slide, if you can see, this was 1 year back when we saw bike riders went into Bhutan and clicked a photo on the top of a stupa, which is regarded as the most important religious place for Bhutanese. Okay, so we should make sure. There was practically no official statement from India. We should not consider our neighbor as, we should not take them as granted. If we should duly give them due recognition. If so, we can easily try to fit in ourselves. Finally, I would like to end a quote from Joseph Nye's work, that a bunch of carrot is far more beneficial than nuclear stick. That's all with my presentation. I hope I have been able to, there are some slides which I've missed, but I hope I've been able to give my viewpoints in the short span of time. Over to the moderators. I'm done. Thank you. Hello.
Thank you, Dr. Arsad.
Thank you.
Now I request Dr. Nizairul Islam to introduce our next speaker and the sub-theme of the webinar.
Mr. Hawk, besides, I am going to introduce the sub-theme and the speaker of the lecture of the Education Department. I would request the participants not to ask for the feedback link again and again, as it has been declared that the feedback link will be shared just 10 minutes before the webinar ends. So please be patient with us and keep watching. Put your views and observation. We will be answering some of the questions at the end of the second session. Relevant questions and observation from the Education Department and Political Science Department would be put one after another at the end of the second session. So be patient with us, please. Don't keep on asking, posting the feedback link again and again. Okay. So thank you, Mr. Hawk, once again. Before the sub-thematic session of the second phase of the webinar, let me speak a few words to set the platform for the session. In the words of Mark Twain, India is the cradle of human race, the birthplace of human speech, the mother of history, the grandmother of legend, and the great grandmother of tradition. Our most valuable and most instructive materials in the history of man are treasured up in India only. Actually, India has long been an educational hub for students from its neighborhood, dating back since 3rd century before Christ. Major Buddhist monasteries that we call Mahaviras, notably those of Pushpagiri, Nalanda, Pallavi, and Takshila, were some of the primary institutions of higher learning in ancient India. The Chinese traveler He Wen Sang visited Pushpagiri in 639 AD. Again, Nalanda was established in 5th century AD and survived until 1200 AD. It was devoted to Buddhist studies, but it also trained students in fine arts, medicine, mathematics, astronomy, politics, and the art of war. It attracted pupils and scholars from Sri Lanka, Korea, Japan, China, Tibet, Indonesia, Persia, and Turkey also. Takshila was an early Hindu and Buddhist center of learning dating 5th century BC. It continued to attract students until the destruction of the city in the 5th century AD. Vikramshila produced eminent scholars who were often visited by foreign countries to spread Buddhist learning, culture, and religion. The most eminent among them being Atish Dipankara, the founder of the Sharma tradition of Tibetan Buddhism. Actually, India's capacity to attract students from her neighborhood nations has helped her to form closer political ties and spread her cultural influence and values to the surrounding nations, especially Nepal, Bhutan, and Afghanistan, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, Myanmar, and Maldives. After independence, as India focused on establishing premier institutions of higher education, students from neighborhood countries began choosing India for higher education. This trend has been encouraged by factors such as cultural similarities, reduced travel time, and lower costs. However, recently China has been our strong competitor and oftentimes than not, proving itself the new destination for neighborhood learners in the sector of tertiary education. Now, the question arises as to why students are ignoring geographic proximity and cultural ties with next door India and instead traveling further to China? The answer lies in the fact that higher education abroad is a holistic experience and one which is affected by many factors such as quality of education, housing, personal safety, security, and city life, all of which play important roles in a student's choice. If India wants more students from the region attending its educational institutions, it must undertake wide-ranging reforms to address the issues undermining its higher education systems and universities. Most policy recommendations to address the issue of decreasing student inflow entail improving institutional quality, attracting qualified faculty, encouraging research, and increasing budgetary allocations, all of which will positively impact India's higher education system. We hope that we'll be learning much more from our learned resource person in this session. Now, a few words. May I now have the pleasure to introduce before you our resource person, Dr. Partho Sarathy Mallick. He will share his knowledge and understanding with us on the topic Higher Education in South Asian Countries, Reality, Challenges, and Opportunities. Before that, a brief introduction about him. Dr. Mallick has an illustrious academic career. He completed his MA in education from Ravenshah University, erstwhile known as Ravenshah College. He did his MPhil from Kalyan University and PhD from Ravindra Bharati University, Kolkata. He started his teaching career in the PG Department of Education, Fakir Chand College, West Bengal, as an assistant professor in the year 2006. And at present, he is serving as an associate professor and the head School of Education, Gangadhar Mehr University, Sambalpur, Odisha. He has completed 3 research projects. published 20 research papers and 13 articles in different national and international journals. He has authored of 3 books so far, published by international publishers. His specific interest areas of research are examination reforms in higher education and sociology of education. So now over to you, Dr. Maulik.
Thanks a lot, Nizarul. Am I audible?
Yes, sir. You are perfectly audible.
Yes. Okay. Thank you.
And you are visible also, okay. Sir. Very good.
Yeah. After a long attempt, I have tried to resolve the problem. What was your query? Okay. So, at the very outset of my presentation, just at a part of the formal system, I would like to express my sincere thanks to the principal of Gadal Mahavidyalaya and my co-colleague and my friend, Dr. Nizarul Islam, and the entire team of the organizing committee who has decided that I can give some extent that I can justify the topic of today's discussion. That is about the South Asian scenario. It may be political aspect, it may be educational aspect. So as a part of my study, my academic field, I decided to discuss about some of the burning scenario or the some of the situations that South Asian countries primarily faced with. So exactly in my presentation discourse, I will provide some of facts, some of the data, and this data or facts has been extracted or taken from the Wikipedia source or some of the works or the surveys conducted at the international level about the enrollment ratio, the expenditure on education, etc. and etc. So these are the things which I will primarily discuss. And my discussion will basically upon the 3 parts I have already mentioned in my topic, that is about the reality of higher education in the South Asian countries and the challenges that the system face, and what are the opportunities that we can make for this context. Exactly, before going to present in detail data regarding this, as I have felt, and I think the maximum participant, also my colleagues, will agree with the opinion that in our educational level, we neglect the higher education. I will go in detail during my presentation how much we have given importance upon our higher education especially. But this higher education is such a level of education that will give not only the credibility to the students at the individual level, but also the social and the national level. Also, it has reflection upon the international level. So, as an academician, as a researcher, I think the scenario of South Asian countries, who are so-called the neighboring countries, as my previous presenter has already discussed about this. So what are the scenario? What are the scenario of higher education in this country? So I will present my presentation will go by. I have prepared some slides. I will show you. Is it visible? Is it visible? Is it visible or not?
No, sir. No, not visible. Not yet, sir. Please share Hello. Your screen, sir. Yeah. Please share your screen, sir.
It is visible.
No, sir. Yet not. Not visible, sir.
Yeah. I will share mine. Okay, 1 minute. Just.
Okay.
Sir. Here the option is in the. I cannot found the option of sharing screen.
Share screen, please. Akidul, help Mr. Maulik, Dr. Maulik. Share screen option, sir.
Can anyone help me how to share the screen?
Akidul, please help Dr. Maulik.
Okay, I'm checking.
Yeah.
Yeah. I see only the 4 and 5 icons, that is mic, cam, and camera mic, chat, and leave. So where will I go?
Can you not find, sir, share screen?
Yeah, no.
Akidul, please help Dr. Maulik.
Please rotate your phone.
I rotate my phone, okay. Oh, rotate my phone, na? Will I make it work for? Yeah.
Is it visible? This sharing option is visible.
Is it possible, or otherwise I will try without slide.
If there is if there is some technical glitch that is beyond recovery, sir, you may present orally.
Okay, no problem. So
okay.
So already previously my co-presenter has already mentioned about the scenario of South Asian countries. Basically, South Asian countries here, I mean to say, the Bangladesh, India, Nepal, Pakistan, and Sri Lanka. Also, Myanmar, Maldives. And the demography scenario of this, if you see the demographic status of these countries, so called the South Asian countries, they together account for around 25% of the world population. And one interesting thing is that approximately 37 population are under the age of 18. That means, I mean to say that on a large section of the youth of the total entire world resides in this subcontinent. And what it is in the South Asian countries is one of the poorest region of the world, because 31% of the population currently under the international poverty line, that is US $1.25 income per day, less than that, according to the World Bank report. That means one thing is clear: the economic condition of economic status of the countries are more or less. And maximum people, a large chunk of the people, are residing under the below poverty line. And 70% of the population lives in rural areas. Another feature of this, while I am discussing about it, I will say that 70% of the population live in the rural areas and rely on the agriculture for their livelihood. And another scenario, demographic scenario of the South Asian country is that there is some sort of political instability and they are vulnerable to the natural disaster. And these countries are known as least developed or developing countries. And another aspect of the demographic scenario is that the youth unemployment in the South Asia is high as 9.6%. With the report of the Times of India, one of the leading newspaper of the day, published that the South Asian youth unemployment, educated unemployment, is 9.6%. So these are the scenario, demographic scenario of this. Then, second thing I would like to discuss, that is why our concern is about the higher education. I have just earlier I have mentioned it. Because if we think about the higher education and the structure of higher education and the effect of higher education, and the effect we find from the four levels, starting from individual level and up to the international level. At the individual level, the higher education is such type of system of education which will empower you for your economic efficiency and make you economically self-reliant. And another aspect is that it gives you the opportunity to express yourself independently with a scientific vision, with a scientific perspective, so that this perspective has implication not only upon your individual life but also the social life. So for this cause, higher education has a significant effect on the individual life. The more educated, the researchers have claimed that there will be more income. And the economic life will be more stable. So at the individual level, the higher education has a significant effect. Also, like individual level, the society which has a more number of graduates and postgraduates, at the social level, the social problems, the social climate, the cultural scenario, this will be also some extent influenced, some extent, not large extent, will be influenced by your educational level. When more educated will be there, they are the way they are, the social process, the social scenario, the process of interaction, healthy living, peaceful living, all these things can be the effect of the higher education. Not only the individual social level, but also the effect of the national level. Because it has been claimed by this answer. That more the higher education, greater will be national development. Because the very word human resource means the empowering individual with the necessary competency, necessary capability, and potentiality so that they can contribute to the national development in a different scenario. So that the higher education is such a level, every country of the world try to give importance. But it is the irony of fact that the country, maximum country in the South Asian region, they are trying hard but unable to succeed. And another part is because we live not only in our individual level but also international level. Because we have to compete with them. We have to contribute at the international level. So the more contribution or the more competition you can do by means of the quality of your higher education. So educational quality of a country, so-called the developed nations, their education system has also the same feature, that their education system is highly developed from ours. So these are the implication of higher education upon the upon different aspects of our life. Just I am giving you, because due to some technical problem I'm unable to present my slide, but still then I'm trying to present orally. If we look the educational enrollment, especially in higher education, to find that Afghanistan, I have taken data from 2011, Afghanistan has the 4% enrollment. I will say regarding two terms we the people of education frequently encounter with. That is gross enrollment, that is another is called net enrollment. The data is about the gross enrollment, what I have said. Afghanistan has the 4% of the enrollment, gross enrollment. And Bangladesh is 13%. It is the year 2012. And Bhutan has 11%. And India has 25%. And this is the from 2013. The data is taken from 2013. And Maldives has also 13%. And Nepal has 17%. And Pakistan has 10%. The data is in 2013. And Sri Lanka is 19%. So these are the only data. But looking at the data, so thing is that only the country like India, where the official it is claimed that the gross enrollment ratio is 25%. I was discussing about the two terms very much interrelated, or we frequently face. One is called the gross enrollment, another is called the net enrollment. The calculating of procedure of gross enrollment procedure is that how much students have enrolled in the different educational institution of your country, especially at the college level and university level. And net enrollment is another aspect where only the specific age group is considered. That means here, those who passed the higher secondary level or those and their age group is in, the age is the specified for the college level or the university level. That means it is a generally, I personally think the data will, the net enrollment ratio will be surely less than the gross enrollment ratio, because this is about the gross enrollment ratio. That means 4% of enrollment is also there in the countries, in the South Asian countries. This is about the scenario for educational gross enrollment ratio of the South Asian country. And if we look at the structural part of the higher education scenario, what are the structure of higher education scenario, we will find that this more or less the scenario is same. That means primarily the country like Bangladesh, India, Sri Lanka, the regulating body is the University Grant Commission.
Hello, Dr. Mullik.
Yeah.
Can you hear me, sir? Please, your voice is buffering sometimes. Sir, can you please your headphone, sir? Your voice is buffering sometimes, sir.
Yeah.
The voice issue is there, sir.
Okay, please, sir.
Yes. Now you are a bit much more.
I am visible. Can you hear me clearly?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
So the regulating body, the regulating organization in Bangladesh, India, and Sri Lanka is UGC. That means the three countries are following the same pattern of administration. And the Afghanistan, in case of Afghanistan, the regulating body is the Ministry of Higher Education. And in case of Pakistan, the body is the Higher Education Commission. That means my point, mention is that the system of governance or the system of monitoring of the higher education is more or less same. Also, some of the legislative framework has been done. And this legislative framework is the directive principle for the so-called, it may be the University Grant Commission, or it may be the ministry, it may be the Higher Education Commission. That means primarily our so-called our regulating body are directed by this ministry, which is primarily politically guided. So this is my focus. Look at another aspect. The another aspect is, I have taken data whenever I presented data, some data maybe you may get update data that is up to the 19, but I have taken primary data up to 2013. The number of universities in Nepal is 12, and the number of university in Bhutan is 2, and the colleges is 13. In case of India, there are 821 universities. The interesting thing is that within the 821 universities, 411 are the state universities, and 120 are the deemed to be universities. As you know, these universities are basically specifically study a particular subject, and 49 are the so-called the central university or the union universities, and 82 are the private universities. This is about the scenario of higher education institution in India. And the number of colleges in India is 39,931 up to 2030. And in case of Bangladesh, the number of universities is 157. And within 157, 53 are the public funded universities. And 103 are the private universities. Look at the scenario, why I am giving stress. And 2 are the international universities who have opened their campus in the Bangladesh. In case of Pakistan, I found there are 156 universities. And within 156, the breakage is that 87 is the public funded university and 69 is the private university up to 2013. And interesting thing is that in case of Sri Lanka, the number of universities is 15. And there is I cannot find any private universities. And Maldives has only one university. So, from this scenario regarding the gross enrollment ratio and the number of universities, especially the private university, trend of the private university and the public funded universities, we can get a data about the South Asian scenario and where we are going to visit. Along with this fact, another fact is that, as we know, this in case of South Asian countries, one of the crucial factor or crucial element that several policymakers or the policymakers from the all of the countries have tried to address, that is the gender issue. If you look at the gender parity index in the South Asian countries, we'll find that in case of the country like Pakistan, Bangladesh, and India, these are the three countries where the girl enrollment is less than the boys. But in case of the Nepal, Sri Lanka, and Maldives, the gender parity index is more than one. When it is more than one, that means it is supports about the higher number of enrollment of the girls. That means I will say at the later stage about the gender perspective in our educational enrollment, especially in higher education, I will say. But this is the fact, the data about the South Asian countries enrollment. An interesting thing is that whatever data I have presented, whatever data I have given you, majority of the enrollment are from the graduate level, confined to the teaching and bachelor degree program, that is BA, BSc and BCom. In case of the postgraduate and research, if you look at the trend, because my focus was we all attempt to give importance of the higher education, because higher education will not only help you for your national development, but also it will contribute to your economy, society and political stability. That means it's a higher implication. But this implication is a direct link with the post-graduation level and the research level. I personally think so. In case of the, if you look at the postgraduate and the research level activities, within the enrollment I just mentioned, in case of Sri Lanka, only 10% enrolled in the either postgraduate or the research program. And in case of the India, it is 18%. And the Nepal, Pakistan has more or less same scenario, it is around 20%. That means if you take the 100% at the total gross enrollment, then nearly about 10 to 20% they are confined with the research at the master degree level. Think about, then we are expecting that why our higher education is not contributing to our national development. Think about the scenario. The basic problem of the higher education in case of the South Asian countries are, I think primarily three. One is the access, another is the equity, and third one is the quality. Because the South Asian countries are making hard efforts to resolve the three issues: to access, to provide equity, and to provide quality. Because in case of the South Asian countries, the discrepancy exists in different levels. One is, for example, gender, social group. Social group, I here mean to say that in case of India, you may consider about the caste, religion. In case of the Muslimic countries like Bangladesh, Pakistan, religion is the one of the factors. This means social group, there is a discrepancy exists between the different social groups. And the third factor of discrepancy, or the third elements of discrepancy that we found, that is the rich and poor. Rich and poor. And the fourth one is the urban and rural. I have already mentioned the 70% of the population are the rural background. That means there is a discrepancy exists between the urban and the rural locality. This is about the equality aspect, so discrepancy aspect. So how we will address this discrepancy, that to be considered. And the another important aspect I have already mentioned, that is the quality concern. The South Asian higher education have a low substandard quality. No university, no single university are termed as the world-class university. These universities are incapable to invite the students from the European countries or the other developed countries. That means quality deterioration or low quality is one of the essential elements of our higher education system in the South Asian countries. And if we look, the reflection of this low standard, it is reflected, it is manifested in terms of the unemployment. The unemployment percentage of country like India is 12%. That means educated unemployment, the graduate unemployment. 12% is from India, and Sri Lanka is 9%. Pakistan is 8%, and Bangladesh is low. Why low? This is another part, because they have no less the low level of unemployment statistics, indicates the different style of management or a different scenario. That means there are primary, there is higher education is the vocational influence. That means our education, higher education, we have to address about the access. I have not addressed yet. I have already mentioned about the access. How much we can provide opportunity to universal access to the students for the higher education, the gross enrollment ratio indicates that. And how much we are capable to provide the equality with the different discrimination that exists within our society. And how much we can able to maintain the standard or the quality of our education. These are the scenario. If you look at the scenario, then we can clearly see the higher education context of the South Asian countries. There is a debate, or you may say that there is a claim made by the academician. That means I found the Indian Academy scenario. They state about the expenditure of the 6% GDP in our education. Then I try to find out where this 6% GDP come. Because the Kothari Commission, that was initiated in the year 1964, they have also recommended about the 6% of GDP. The University Grant Commission, Radhakrishna Commission, in the year 1948, they have also suggested for the expenditure of 6% GDP of GDP in the education. In the year 2020, when I saw the document where the government is saying that we will try to make expenditure of the 6% GDP, it is very interesting, because this is a norm given by the UNESCO and UNDP, that at least 6% of the GDP should be spent for the education in case of the South Asian countries, or the undeveloped or the developing countries. So we have not achieved yet. Look at the statistics, it will be very interesting. Up to the year 2013, the India has spent 3.8% of the GDP on the education. And Sri Lanka only 2%, Bangladesh 2.8%, Pakistan 2.2%, Bhutan 7.4%, Maldives 5%, 2% as on 2009. I am saying about the 2009, and the data about India is 2013. There is an interesting thing within this expenditure on education. The lion's share of this expenditure is on the either on the primary education or the secondary education. So you can imagine about the expenditure of the higher education. A liar say, a expenditure is made on the primary education or the secondary education. Because I think, personally think, all the South Asian countries have made the legislative framework either to universalize or in a stage of universalization of this primary and secondary education. That means maximum amount is spent on the primary and secondary education. What about the higher education thing? Imagine. And another thing you will notice that when there is a reduction of the, or there is a cut of the education, cut of the GDP on the education, what are the reflections we noticed? Large number of seats are vacant in the education institution. Okay? Then the recruitment procedure, primarily done by the state government universities, also the central government universities. Interesting to see. The post nomenclature like para teacher, ad hoc teacher, which are either underqualified or underpaired with the teacher. Okay. That means this is the reflection of the power or the reflection of the expenditure quota or expenditure reduction on the higher education. So as a result, there is another reflection we noticed. The higher education teaching profession becoming less attractive. When one student noticed that lots of seats are laying vacant and no recruitment are going on, then why would I try to enter into the profession? Because there is no job. So as a matter of fact, what happened? The talented or the very competent or the very skilled, energetic youths, they switch up to the another profession. As a result, what happens? The seats filled up by the education institution, they have to either take the low quality or the under quality. This is the scenario of the, this is the reflection of the reduction of the cut. And another interesting thing you will find, when there is a high demand made by the society or made by the academician about the expansion of the higher education, then the government is creating an alternative modalities to cope up the situation. The alternative modality is primarily distance education or the opening education. Maximum universities, sorry, maximum South Asian countries, they have opened the national, either national level or the state level universities. Those can afford the higher education courses in distance mode. So this is about the scenario. So if we, I have tried to focus my challenges upon seven parameters. What are the major challenges the higher education of the South Asian countries face? The first challenge is, as I think, there is a mismatch between the demand and supply. That means the demand for higher education comes from society and the academician. We demand high because we have felt that more the higher education, better will be our living standard. The better will be our national growth and development. As a result, what happened? The policymakers or the governance try to enroll the students by different modalities. I would say the modalities are either opening up the new universities or colleges, or providing an alternative mechanism like open and distance education, or the third one is inviting the private enterprise to open the education institution, that is called private education institution, private universities or private colleges. So the governance or the policymakers, to match our demand, they have to open it. And what happened? Because within this demand supply mechanism, you will find the problem. What happened? Number of graduates or postgraduates gradually increasing day by day. And what they expect? They expect employment. And the employment sector primarily we think two. One is public sector, another is the private sector. And the public sector, interesting thing is that.
Hello, Mollik sir.
Hello. Yeah, yeah.
I beg your pardon, sir. Please, sir. We are running late behind time. So please conclude within 5 to 7
okay,
minutes,
okay.
Sir, please.
Okay.
Thank you.
So what happened? We as an academician, we as a common people, we prefer private bodies. Whenever my personal observation is concerned, if I have to opt for a school to sending my son and daughter, then I have to opt for the private schools. But in the other case, I am demanding for the employment in the government sector or the public sector. This mismatch, that means we demand higher education, also we demand employment. But scenario is that we opt for the private because we think that the quality assurance part is the high in case of the private college. So this is the mismatch model primarily happens. And already I have mentioned about the access and equity. That means there is a lots of inequality parameter between boys and girls, rich and poor, and the caste-based discrepancy, religion-based discrepancy, geographical location-based discrepancy. We are facing a lots of problem and quality for parameter. And one thing I would like to discuss with you, we need the quality, although there are lots of suggestions have been made by academicians, like the lack of high quality researchers, faculty member, well equipped instruments. I personally think, apart from this, another part is very serious. That is the politicization of the higher education institution. Directly or indirectly, the educational governance, at the institutional governance level, the political interference we found, starting from the employment towards our day-to-day activity. So what happens? That means as an autonomous body, the South Asian countries cannot able to provide the situations or provide a good outcome, a remarkable outcome from their higher education institution. So this political interference or the political aspect or political link of the institution within the education institution is a prevailing scenario, and it's one of the challenging scenario. And you look another part I was discussing about the demand supply mismatch mechanism, because these sectors for the employment, they require the particular skill that is called competency. The competency is not what you know, rather your emotional attachment with your knowing and the reflection in terms of your action to do this. The integration of your knowledge, your emotion and your action can provide you the competence. But it is a very ironical situation. That means the graduate and postgraduate students, after completing their degrees, they are not preferred by our job provider sector, like private sector or the public sector. That means whenever I will suggest about the some opportunities, my discussion project is already, Nihal has mentioned me that time is very, we are running very late. Still then I am trying to link these challenges with one of my opportunity. So delinking this political interference with autonomy can do a little bit help. I don't know how much it is feasible, because my personal experience is that as I am right now, I am serving as one of the eastern state of Odisha. Two employees the government of Odisha provides as administrator, that is called the register and the FO. That means university as an autonomous body, it's not completely become autonomous. We have to adapt every principle, every directives of the government. I was just giving an example of one of the scenario. The same scenario happens in case of the starting from the JNU to the very remote universities or the very, very village-based universities. The same scenario happens. So delinkage of this political scenario with the higher education scenario can provide one opportunity. And another opportunity is, as I think, This is very much clearly in our new education policy that is in a, introduced just 10 or 20 days before. That is one thing is that employability, how to generate employment. So employability is primarily depends upon the curricular setup, what you are teaching, how you are teaching, what you are producing. If you are producing a skilled and competent, and the skill and competent should be primarily market driven. And purposefully I am using the word market driven, because majority of the employment is the in the private sector. Still then in case of public sector, we also as a common man, we expect quality. And we think that the government servant or the government employees, they are not providing quality. That means another thing is that, that means the regulating procedure of the public funded universities or the public funded university should be very strict. And they can adapt to the mechanism of the private bodies, because we expect, we think personally, we think at the personal level that the private schools, there is a high quality of education. Although we know the teacher quality is very low, but still then we believe the quality is high. Then the question is that why? It is not our mindset. Exactly, the monitoring aspect of the private bodies is very much high. You have to produce a large number of publications. We have to do a good research, and lots of parameters they fix, and we have to adjust with the parameters. Then after we can continue our service. But in case of a public service like college and university, what happened? Once enter into the profession, no problem. He will retire at the age of the 65 or the 60. Nothing to bother about this. And he will get the promotion and etc. That means this model of quality assurance in case of public or private bodies has some relevance in case of the educational administration of our public funded universities. I am saying about the entire scenario of the South Asian countries. There is a wild rush to the public institute. The students are opting for them. There's a high campus-based employment. But in case of our government institution, what happens? These things we lack. And another thing is that we have to change our attitude. As a policymaker, we have to change our attitude. Because within the challenges, I personally think, and the policymaker or the governance and the beneficiary group, that is the university and the colleges, lots of bureaucrats are there. And bureaucrats have a certain bent of mind. They think that the education sector will run like a immediate return approach. That means we invest this amount of money, the outcome will come within 1 and 2 years. No, this is not the reality. Our mindset should be changed. We have to focus our mindset that this is a long-term investment. Our quality will come after a long time. We have to see. And the monitoring part is also very serious.
Dr. Mallick, can you hear me, sir? Yes, I think he has completed the lecture. Thank you, Dr. Mallick, for your engaging delivery. You have put enough light on the higher education scenario of India, shedding important light on the different dimensions. You have also shed light on the picture, problem, and prospect of higher education scenario in South Asian countries. And your lecture also hinted at the disparity that exists in higher education sector in comparison to the European nations. Now, we will be having a very short interactive session with our resource persons. only two prominent questions will be there for each resource persons of today's webinar. Now, may I ask Mr. Hawk to put the first observation by the participants to the resource person of the political science department. Mr. Hawk, can you hear me, Mr. Hawk?
Thank you, Dr. Islam. Yes, okay, yes. Thank you, Dr. Yes. Islam. We have received so many observations and questions to the resource person. I put my first question from B2 Paul. That is, observing the current scenario, sir, how you see India's neighborhood policy toward Himalayan countries? Is it ideological chaos? I repeat, observing the current scenario, sir, how you see India's neighborhood policy towards Himalayan countries? Is it ideological chaos?
Okay. Hello. Am I audible? Hello. Hello. Phone
yes.
Yes,
yes.
So basically, yes. The question which is raised by B2 Paul. Thank you so much for asking this question. My answer will be very short and very simple. When we talk about an interconnected global world order, specifically after the reconstruction of this economic order. Ideologies play a very small role or very miniature role when economy comes into play. The atrocities China is doing over the Muslims in the Zuba region, Pakistan apparently is silent on it. And so it's clear, I believe I have made my point clear, that ideological this differentiations or ideological problems hardly can change the discourse of relationship between two nations presently at this point of time. What I believe that apparently instead of ideology, a few important factors which are important, which is the real bone of contention, is the way we are handling with our neighbors. I think we need to be more compassionate and we need to be more less bossy in dealing with our neighbor. The construction of 80 kilometers of road, which is the major problem between India and Nepal, I think this could have been done in a much more time-taking, easy manner. I think if we discuss the matter on the table, we could have easily solved the question. We could have easily solved the problem. Second, some loose talks by diplomats, not diplomats, but political government officials, political leaders. These affects a lot. Say, for example, there was a recent case when there was a aid, which was economic assistance, which was given in Bangladesh, and someone in India branded it as tran or donation. These loose talks needs to be taken into consideration, I think. Apart from ideology, the way we handle our neighbor is more important.
Thank you, Dr. Tanvir Arshed. Hello.
You're welcome, sir. I hope I'm able to,
Okay, sir, you have satisfied. Now, there is an observation on part of Dr. Varam Venkata Narasheya to Dr. Mollick. Is new education policy 2020 having any impact on neighboring countries? Dr. Mollick. Dr. Mollick, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Yes. So the question is that, is new education policy 2020 having any impact on neighboring countries?
Look at the scenario. I will prefer to focus my answer upon the two aspects. One is, within the South Asian countries, India is one of the leading countries. Starting from enrollment to the quality assurance, because India is the only country where the neighboring countries prefer to send their children. So this new education policy of government of India, as given, there is a large opportunity for the curricular changes. Look, the way the policy framers has conceptualized, that has high relation with the employment, not only employment but also attached with our indigenous culture and the context for application and for knowledge and skills, and ultimately that will lead to your national level progress. I personally think if India can able to make a good plan of action for this and execute the policy as it has been suggested by the policy members, if it can executively properly, that means 6% of the GDP will be opened, and the curricular and methodological reformation that is primarily multidisciplinary, interdisciplinary, can be initiated. So this can I personally think has a high relation with the employment, employability. It will increase the employability of our educational system, and ultimately the neighboring countries can imitate this model, and as a result, along with India, they can also get benefit. I personally think so. If they can, my last aspect is that I have already mentioned that it depends upon the proper plan of action. Otherwise, it will remain as a policy document. Because I have mentioned spending of 6% GDP has not been achieved till date. It has been mentioned in the year 1948. In the 2020, the government admit that we are unable to spend 6% of GDP. I expect the things would happen in the way the policy framework has done. If it will happen in that way, the curricular change and the investment on the higher education, and of course, I think the South Asian countries can get also benefit from this by imitating or by utilizing this type of models in their countries. I personally think so.
Yeah, Arsit.
Yeah, Nidhar.
Akidul. Mr. Akidul Haq. Mr. Akidul Haq.
Yes, yes.
Hello, do you have any other observation regarding political science?
Am I audible?
Yeah, please.
Yes. The second question is from Aliul Haq. He put a question that is, present nature of relationship with the neighboring countries is the failure of India's neighborhood policy or the success of China's money back policy?
Okay.
Dr. Arsa.
Can I answer the?
Yes. Hello.
Yeah.
Okay. Quickly answering the second question. Let me make myself clear that in the discourse of international relations, there are no permanent friend. There are no permanent enemies. All is what exists are common and shared interest. India need to make India's failure in order to garner a strong support amongst the smaller South Asian country. I would not blame completely China, because China is not a part of this. China do play a very vital role. But apart from China, I think India is losing the opportunity to utilize the failure of China and uphold its image in it. Say, for example, Chinese debt trap diplomacy, the diplomacy which China is using right now. It's going to smaller nation, funding in a huge amount of money, and then trying to use it as a debt.
smaller countries are failing to repay that money, and they are turning as a like smaller colonies of China. Okay, India need to harp on these aspects. India need to make sure that these are some of the problematic factors which comes in when China is a negotiating partner with a smaller country. The reason why India is not preferred as a good beneficial partner is because of the problem or rigid structure of bargain. Unlike China, India is much more rigid when you talk about any sort of trade related policies. So India need to harp on these failure of China and need to revive its image among the small South Asian countries. I would like to end by one line that we can't change our borders. We can't change our neighbors. But what we can do is that we can make them irrelevant. We can make them irrelevant by giving more and more due recognition to our long-term policies. We can make them irrelevant by making people-to-people contracts. We can make them irrelevant by negotiating border disputes. And China is a contender. It's not a sole important player. China can't shape up India's policy towards its neighbor. Although it's one of the most crucial partner, although crucial factor, although I think that satisfies the answer of Alul. Yeah.
Thank you, Dr. Tanvir Arshid. Now, due to the paucity of time, there were a lot of observations and questions by the participants from both political science and education department. But due to lack of time, we cannot take all those questions and observations. So there is the last one and the second one for Dr. Maulik. Another question was that, observation was that. Chair, can you please shed some light on India's education diplomacy? Please shed some light on India's education diplomacy.
Sorry, Nizarul, I can't catch the point.
Actually, the observation question was that, sir, can you please shed some light on India's education diplomacy? Can you shed some light on India's education diplomacy? Hello, sir. Can you hear me? Hello, Dr. Maulik. Can you hear me, sir? Sir, am I audible to you, sir? Sir, Dr. Maulik, sir, am I audible, sir? What is your observation regarding India's education diplomacy, sir? I think there might be some technical glitch on the part of Dr. Maulik. Hello?
Yeah, am I audible? Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. The last question was that, sir. The question was that, sir.
Very good question. Very good question.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Please.
Basically, my observation is that the SAARC is a collaborating unit. It is a one unit decided by at the political level for the regional cooperation. And as a matter of fact, so the regional cooperation within the South Asian countries, one university was established, South Asian universities. And the university is one of the campus within JNU. Okay. And right now, what happens? My observation is that we always make a benchmark to the so-called developed nation. But this is my first time I am discussing about the education scenario of Pakistan, Bangladesh, Maldives, Afghanistan. Because as a matter of our education stream, we always try to compare our education with so-called the nations developed. That is the European, basically European countries. This is my observation. Another part is that. So At the regional level, if you look at the East Asia, there is a high collaboration within their countries. And the, within East Asia, there is a mutual exchange of the resource, mutual exchange of the students, and the policy frameworks is very much done, basically more or less similar perspective. But in case of the South Asian countries, these things doesn't happen. Because Pakistan, Bangladesh, right now the Nepal, the relation, international relation between the neighboring countries to see India, but because I am not expert in this political science, still then I think some extent these countries also do not prefer to the India as a model for their education scenario. Because Bangladesh will not prefer India as the model of the education, so that India can stress its hand of cooperation. Or Pakistan, neither the, in case of Nepal also. Before some days, Nepal was sending a large amount of students to the Indian universities. But right now, they are trying to send them to the global scenario. That means in the European, so-called European developed universities. So I personally think this is one type of mindset, and the relations should be established in a diplomatic level. Then after these reflections will happen in case of the education. Otherwise, this is not. Because only countries India can import students, or students can prefer to get neighboring country, that is India. No Indian students prefer to go to Pakistan, Nepal, or Bangladesh, or Myanmar, or etc. This is the scenario. So I think this situation should be basically started at the political level. Personally, I think so.
Okay, sir. Thank you, Dr. Mullick, for satisfying participants on this question, on this observation. Over to you, Akidul.
Thank you.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Over to you, Akidul, sir. Can you hear me?
Okay.
Yes, please. Please thank you, don't thank go you. Out of screen.
Yeah. Now, yes, yes. Now, I would like to ask Dr. Nizarul Islam to extend the vote of thanks for the webinar.
Thank you, Mr. Hawk, for giving me the honor of extending vote of thanks in this webinar. At the very onset, I would like to thank Dr. M.D. Shamsul Hawk, Honorable Principal of our college, for allowing Department of Political Science and the Department of Education of the college to organize this webinar. Thank you, sir, so much. Without your support, this webinar could not have turned into a reality. Our sincere thanks goes to the resource persons of this evening, Dr. Tanveer Arsed, Assistant Professor, Department of Political Science, Presidency University, Kolkata, and Dr. Partho Sharuthi Mollik, Associate Professor and the Head, School of Education, Gangadhar Mehr University, Sambalpur, Odisha, for their kind presence and enlightening deliberation on the sub-themes of the webinar. Thank you, sirs. It is you who have made this webinar an encouraging and engaging one to the participants. I would like to thank Dayamantha Roy, Assistant Professor, Department of Political Science, Mr. Debabroto Mondol, Assistant Professor, Department of Education, Mr. Shuparto Ghosh and Mr. Amit Kumar Prasad, state-aided college teachers, Department of Political Science, Mrs. Kavita Sharkar and Mr. Dipankar Kundu, state-aided college teachers, Department of Education, for their support to make this webinar a success. Thank you, my colleagues. Mr. Shyamal Kumar Ghosh, Assistant Professor, Department of English, has voluntarily helped with his technical expertise to organize this webinar. Thank you, Mr. Mondol, Mr. Ghosh. And last but not the least, I thank all my colleagues and the participants of this webinar, without whom this webinar would not have been a reality, and without whom this webinar would have surely lost its color and spirit. Thank you all and one. So now, may I request our principal, sir, to declare the end of the webinar. Sir, over to you.
Thanks, Mr. Dr. Nizarul Islam. We are very glad to listen this topics and the lecture of Dr. Tanvir Arshed and Dr. Partha Sarathy Mallik. They delivered valuable lectures and we enjoyed the interactive session in this period. We would like to conclude this session and we have to forward the next webinar's meeting. Hope I will be thankful to you also that if they come again and enlighten us with the valuable and enlightening discussions. We are interested in their lectures. We are very much pleased to hear this lessons. Thanks to all, and I conclude this session. Thanks.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Dr. Arshed. Thank you, Dr. Mallik. Thank you, Mr. Hawk. Thank you, Shamol, and each and every of my colleagues who have really extended their very helping hand to make this webinar a reality. Thank you.
Thank you, all of you. Thank you.
Good night. Good night.
Good night.
Good night. Now, Akhidul, Mr. Hawk, I request you to end the show.